Johns Hopkins person.
I'm a major Johns Hopkins person. If you have any questions about Hopkins, let me know. I actually started doing what I'm doing because I was a really involved alum. And I used to interview students, and I used to train alumni how to interview students. And I used to, you know how the college reps come to your schools? So the college rep for Hopkins would call me and say, hey, I'm going to be in LA. I'm visiting these schools. And I would go, well, that's great. What about these? And she would be like, oh, I don't have time. And I was like, well, I do. So she would mail me a box of stuff, and I would go. I had places with one of my schools, actually. I would go, like, do that, you know, college rep thing, even though I'm not that staff person. And I just watched the kids, you know, get so stressed out. And you guys deal with this every day. Like, I see them, you know, every couple weeks, and in the season, in the fall, I see them every week, but it's still only once a week. And you guys see that daily sort of craziness. So thank you for all the work that you do. So I bet that Rebecca's covered this. And what I wanted to start with was this little parable that I use, which is if you go to the supermarket when you're hungry, but you don't really know what you're hungry for, you put a whole bunch of stuff that you don't need in your basket. And I equate this to building a college list, because if all you know is what you know, and you don't think about, and I'm not talking about you now, I'm talking about the students and their parents, if all you can think about, if all you have the capacity to think about is what you know, then you're going to put the wrong schools into your basket or onto your list. And so we view the process, and I'm sure you've talked about this, as kind of a two-phase process, right? Phase two is applying to college. That's what you do in the fall of senior year. But phase one is searching for colleges. And that's the part, to me, that is exciting and takes time. And if you put some effort into, they put some effort into research and going beyond what they know, then they might have a pleasant surprise. If they come to you, like they come to us, and they say, it has to be UCLA or USC, right? That's what we get all the time. It has to be UCLA or USC. If that's all they know and all they want, they're probably going to be disappointed. And so I feel like my job is to help get them to the point where, like literally on the way here, I was talking to a dad who was telling me about how disappointed he was with his daughter's AP scores, right? She got 2 threes on whatever, history and English, and how disappointed he is. I know. And the conversation we had before was how disappointed he was in her semester grades. And I'm thinking, you know, she probably can feel that you're disappointed.
Yeah.
Right? And so here I am giving parenting advice. P.S. I'm not a parent. You know, to this guy who is just continually disappointed. And I said, I gotta tell you something. We're gonna have more disappointment in the next 9 months. I promise you, she will get rejected from somewhere. Like, I know what's on her list. So what I try to have them do is, let's think about what should be on my shopping list. What do I need when I go to the supermarket? And so I brought this set of cards. Have you shown them these cards? So the funny part is the cards have changed, and they don't look like this anymore, and I didn't bring my new set. But there's this awesome woman in Seattle, and the company is called Corsava. If you go on Corsava.com, it's just like it sounds, C-O-R-S-A-V-A. The cards are basically a sorting activity, and you have them sort the cards into must-have, don't-care, don't-want. And now there's a fourth one, so it's like must-have, would-be-nice, don't-care, don't-want. And I do this in front of parents, and I've done this in big classrooms too, actually. There's 110 cards in here, and it's got everything that you, maybe not everything, but so many things that you and they certainly have not thought about. So, do you need to go to a college where there's cultural events nearby? That goes in the must-have category. Career advising, film, history, world languages, biology, alternative grading system. Do you have a learning difference? Maybe this is for you. It just gets them thinking, like, what is it that I'm looking for? Instead of just throwing colleges onto a list, let me think about what kind of environment will be the right academic, social, and emotional environment for me. So the cards are called Corsava, C-O-R-S-A-V-A, and they are $30 a set.
Okay.
But I'll tell you, what she's done, the woman who runs it, what she's done is she's turned it into an online system too. So when you buy the cards, you get the electronic version too, and you can have kids sort online. And they can actually look at every single card and click, because you know they don't do cards anymore, they do clicking. They can actually look through all of these categories, and she hasn't divided up into like support and academic and cultural and all sorts of different categories. Because if you get them thinking about what I'm looking for, maybe you can get them past that whole like, what I'm looking for is the name actually start researching colleges. But what I do is I pick colleges that I know that they've never heard of. And what I want them to do, so I have them sort their cards. And then when we get to them, when we get a whole pile, because remember, there's 100 cards in here. We usually get a whole pile of the must-haves, right? It could be far from home. It could be snow. It could be whatever. It could be a million things. When we get that pile of must-haves, I make them pick their top 10. Give me the top 10 priorities for you for college. When they have those cards, I line them up 5 over 5. I have them take a picture and carry it around with them in their phone. So this is called, I have them look at it. I say, does this look like what you're looking for? And they go, yeah, kind of. And then when I pull up a college website, I say, okay, how do we find these 10 things? Is it school spirit? Where do we find them? Is it far from home? How do we figure that out? Is it one of the academic subjects? Let's dig into the history department or the political science department or whatever. Let's see what that academic experience is going to look like. And one of the things I say to the students is, right now I know you're worried about the getting in part, but what I'm worried about and what your parents are worried about is you getting out. So with a degree, yes. So what does it look like for you to be a history major here, or a math major, or a, I'm sure you have kids come to you and say, I never ever want to take math ever again, right? I was one of those kids. And so they need to know what's going to be expected. They might come to you and say, I don't want to take foreign language, I'm tired of taking whatever I've been taking, right? So what's going to be expected of them to graduate in 4 years? So I have them do lots of digging on that. And I, like I said, I purposely give them schools that I know they don't know, because what I'm trying to get them used to is realizing that the things they're looking for, you can't find them everywhere. You have to really look for them. And so when you find them, you should feel special about that, and maybe put that aside or write that name down. So that's the first thing I do. The other resource that you can use that does not cost $30 is, I don't know if you can see this one, there's, pass around. There's a website called mymajors.com, and you can set up a free counselor account in it. I have an account, so my clients go to magellan.mymajors.com. They'll set it up for you for free. It's all online. The kids go through a little quiz. It's kind of half and half, so it does a little bit of academic, like what classes were you good at, and what you but it does. There's a whole bunch of sort of style questions, like, do you like to work with your hands? Do you like to work on teams? Do you like to work outside? Do you like to work on big picture or individual issues? And at the end, once you get to the very end of this quiz, it'll take like 10 to 15 minutes, it will actually pop out a list of about 10 possible majors that they could be thinking about. Now, it's not perfect. It's definitely not perfect. I've had it be totally off sometimes. But there have been times where, I had a boy do it one time, and actually, this was a couple years ago. And at the end, it came up that he was interested in urban planning. And he was like, yeah, I'm all over that. He lived in like a mid-century modern, house up in the hills. And he was like, yeah, I'm totally into urban planning. And his mom said to me, I had no idea he was interested in urban planning. It's because he didn't even know. Because what kids know is what their mom does, what their dad does, what their Uncle Joe does, and what their best friend's mom does, right? That's all they know. They know this much. So that's one of the things I love about my majors, is it just helps them see a little bit broader what's out there. And what it does is it'll prepare for you a report. It's about 15 pages, and usually I give them that for them to read. And it'll explain each of the majors. And then in conjunction with that, my next favorite website, I'm not kidding, here it is, ready? It's called whatcanidowiththismajor.com. there's a place where you go on that website. I think you have to do like /majors or something like that. But it's whatcanidowiththismajor.com. And there's a page where it gives you just boxes, and every box is a major. And when you click on the box, it'll tell you what jobs have that major. If you need an advanced degree to get those jobs, what employers hire people who have that major. So it just kind of helps them go beyond. And like Rebecca said, for me it's all about making the list bigger before we make it smaller, right? Because I feel like the sort of trend is they're going to come to you and they're going to say, UCLA, USC, okay, maybe I'll go to Santa Barbara, right? We always cringe when that happens, because have you seen the numbers for Santa Barbara lately? But, they'll come to you and they'll go, okay, maybe UC San Diego. Okay, maybe UC Santa Barbara. And I feel like my job is, and you're all going to the College Fair Sunday? Awesome, awesome. These are awesome, awesome colleges. And let me just say something about this. These are private, mostly private. There's at least two public in here, mostly private, mostly small, mostly liberal arts. These are schools that love California kids, and when I say love, I mean scholarship. Okay, so I'll give you an example. I have a kid who lives in a beautiful house in Manhattan Beach who does not need a scholarship, who is going to a school in this book for about what it will cost, what it would have costed to, for her to go to a UC. Okay, because they loved her and because she's a good fit, and she, and they could tell from her application that she had really explored and understood what they were offering. Okay, so that was the first resource I'm going to give you.
It's a book two.
Okay, the second, I don't know if you talked about, is RAP. Have you guys talked about RAP?
Yeah.
Oh, so wow, I have nothing then. RAP is great. You should all, you saw how quickly, like, Rebecca calls, they come, right? You call.
They're the Bennington and the Dickinson people that are part of that group.
And 20 of them will come. All you guys have to do is call and give them a date, and they love you. It's like their job, so give them work to do. And then the last thing I want to give you was WUI. Have you talked about WUI?
A little bit, not a lot.
Okay, so let me tell you why I love WUI. WUI stands for Western Undergraduate Exchange. And whenever someone comes to me and says, we really want to stay in California because it's cheaper, I say, sit down, because I'm in a lecture now. it's not. The WUI is an agreement that the Western states, basically from North and South Dakota all the way to Alaska and Hawaii, they made this agreement with each other in the 50s. And the purpose was to keep West Coast kids from going east for college, right? And so it's not working very well, but they're trying. So you know how in-state tuition is X, and then out-of-state tuition is usually about three times X? Mm-hmm. So what the WUI agreement is instead of charging three times as much for all of the Western state residents' children, we'll just charge you about 1.5 times, right? So it kind of cuts the cost of out-of-state tuition about in half. There's good news and there's bad news. The bad news is not every school participates, right? So University of Oregon does not have to incentivize California kids to come to Oregon. They're going up there in droves. Neither does University of Washington, neither does University of Arizona or Arizona State. There's probably a few other exceptions. So not all schools participate, and some schools only participate for some majors. So for some schools, some majors are restricted. If you go on the WUI website, and honestly, if you just Google WUI, Western Undergraduate Exchange, it'll pop up. You can search by state, you can search by major, you can search by two-year, four-year program. The truth is, California is not very generous with being reciprocal, right? And there's a reason, right? We have enough kids to fill our state university system. So basically, we're taking our own students first, which is what we're supposed to do. But that's why it makes it harder for us to help it financially, you know, for out-of-state kids to come in. And that makes it harder, a little harder for California kids to go out. But there are some schools on that list that are fabulous. They will end up costing your kids less than they would pay, not just at a UC, but at a Cal State. So let me give you an example. There's a school in Washington State on the eastern side of Washington, which, by the way, is not the rainy side. It's the snowy side, right? I was shocked when I got there. It was hot and dry at the end of, in like October. So there's a school called Eastern Washington University. It is just outside of Spokane. If you land in Spokane, you can literally take the public bus. It's about 20 minutes away. It's beautiful. It is D1 football. Their football field is painted red. They call it the Inferno. I mean, these people are not joking about their football. So if you have a kid who wants school spirit and D1 and rah-rah and PS, they're going to graduate in 4 years, and it will cost them a whopping $23,000 a year. So when a parent comes to you and says, you know, Cal States are really the best option for California students, you look them right in the eye and you say, I want you to know what the four-year graduation rate is at California State University. Sorry, it's not good. And at out-of-state public universities that are generally half the size, like Eastern Washington has 14,000-15,000 undergraduate students. So they're going to get much better attention. Obviously, I'm generalizing about the Cal States. I'm not trying to spit on this system. I know for many kids it works very, very well. But I'm just trying to give you some ammunition. When people come to you and say, California, you have to stay in state because it's cheaper, you tell them, it's not always true. So, okay, those are my three big ideas, and you already had two of them.
They have to hit more than once.
Good question.
I don't know if you want to mention the fact that Northern Nevada University, they also fly you in for one day. They fly you in at 8 o'clock in the morning, they bring you back at 5 o'clock.
Right.
And they give you a tour of the campus.
You mean University of Nevada?
Yes, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Reno.
You guys should all, so Michaela is the rep there, and
right.
She's a member of RAC, and you guys should all, it's one day in May, and it's University of Nevada at Reno, which they are very quick to tell you is the flagship. UNLV is not the flagship of the Nevada system. And Michaela will meet you at LAX at like 7 in the morning, and she'll fly you up to Reno, and you will spend the whole day on the campus, and she'll fly you back in time for dinner. It's an awesome, your head will explode, but it's an awesome way to learn about the systems. And same thing with Reno. If a kid has over 3.0, they're almost automatically in, and they are WUI. So it's an absolutely great deal.
My cousin, who refused to spend any money on her kid's education, her son went there because he wanted to do hydrology. Who knew? They have a hydrology major. And he stayed for his master's, and he has no debt.
Yep, and they have great journalism. They have
mining. They have mining as well.
They do. And I visited it because WACAC was there when they did that Super ACA.
I would say about UNLV, the one in Las Vegas, they have basically the number 2 or 3 hospitality program in the country. So if you have kids, so one of the things I love about this major is if you have a kid who's like, I'm sort of good at math, I kind of like business, I don't know what I want to do with it. Hospitality is like one of my favorite majors. This is how I describe it. You get to make money off of other people going on vacation. Okay, that's a job.
You need
to
make people happy.
That's a career path. That's awesome. And honestly, they could go to UNLV and spend not as much money as they would spend on Cal State. Absolutely be done in 4 years. The other thing I love about hospitality is they sort of move around. But you know, when you're in your 20s, you're a little bit more mobile. So you spend 6 months on Maui. You spend 6 months in Boulder. And then you kind of figure out where you want to live your life. Wow, this is not a rough way to start your career. So, yeah.
The lot of kids that we have would be very good in the hospitality industry, especially since they're bilingual and have
Absolutely. Yeah,
what was the second thing that you wanted to mention, but I wasn't sure what it was? There was 3 things that you said you mentioned.
The first one. It was passing around right now.
The book, The Colleges That Change Lives.
No, that was the second thing.
Oh, the middle one was RAC, the Regional Admissions.
Oh, yeah.
So those are the guys who came in on Thursday.
So, you've done the card activity.
Yeah.
You know to determine the 10 must-haves for the student.
Yeah.
Then what's your next step? Is it, when you were first starting out and didn't know, have the knowledge that you do now of the different colleges, what would you recommend to us?
It's a great question.
Going into this, fall, where do we start? Because we don't know.
Right. I mean, the truth is, the College Board Big Future website does have a search engine, and that's definitely a nice place to start. You can pare down geographically, you can pare down that major, that's a good place to start. I would also, honestly, I would go to the RAC website and just familiarize yourself with the schools on that list, just because
there are 110 of them on the list right now.
Yeah,
that's
and
crazy.
It's so easy for you to pick up the phone and get real answers that are related to California kids. So you can call Chuck Lydiard and go, tell me about Delaware, how many California kids do you have? Like, I have a California kid who wants to be a kinesiology major, like exercise science. Apparently Delaware has an amazing, amazing program, and I sort of forced her to go visit last spring, and she was totally not excited about visiting, and it was totally the hit of the trip. So now I know I can call Chuck, basically, and help figure out if, what's it going to look like for her? Is she a scholarship candidate? They're such a great resource. So I would do that.
Also, my list of fly-in colleges, because if they're willing to fly your kids in, they're willing to talk to you about them.
Yes. Yeah.
Have you had to deal with students that want to study internationally, like in England or
yeah.
country? And
yep.
How have you advised them on that?
So this is kind of hard, and there are a couple RAC members. There's one from Macquarie University in Australia. There's one from Franklin University in Switzerland, and there's
Paris.
Say it again?
American University in Paris.
American University in Paris, and there's also a whole cluster of British and Irish. The truth is, if you call the British consulate here, they keep in really good touch with the universities, and they also have a fly-in.
They have a fly to England. That'd be so much fun.
They have a fly-in to England.
The consulate has a fly-in?
I don't know if the consulate runs it, but the university. So here's what I've discovered, though, because especially last fall, I had a whole bunch of kids, you know, saying to me, like, if Trump wins, I'm out of here, you know, get out of here for 4 years. And I had one who was very, very close. She basically came down to Berkeley or University College London. And I feel like for a California kid, right, huge difference, for a California kid, it's just a little bit more than they're willing to commit to. So I feel like they apply. Like, I've been through the UCAS application a million times, and if I were you, I would create an account in the UCAS and just go through it so you know what's in it.
And it's not user-friendly.
But it's not user-friendly at all. But I think that in the end, you're going to find, even if your students apply and are admitted, they're probably not going to go, but it's worth knowing the process.
So what's the website again?
UCAS, UCAS.
That's the system that all the British universities use,
British,
like the Common
App. And just so you know about the British universities, they're all three-year bachelor degrees, but here's what you miss. You pick a major when you go in. They call it a program. There's no electives. Like, that's all you do. That's what you miss when, it's like if you picked your major in college and all you did was your major, you would miss all this other fun stuff. So it sounds good. It seems less expensive. There's a lot you miss.
And they're certainly not going to give first-gen kids any money.
No.
So it's for middle class kids, right?
Yes.
Or upper class kids.
I've been asked a question. I had a kid that was adamant about going to England.
Yeah.
And I have no experience.
Yeah, he's not
going to
get any money.
So I told him, just go to the website, see what you can find out, see about financial aid, and
what I tell the kids is, let me tell you about studying abroad.
Yeah.
And that when you go to college, you can study a year in England.
And
you go to London School of Economics, you can do all these different things. It's much better to go there for studying abroad than to go for college.
And your financial aid for studying abroad, like 99% of the time, your financial aid will
cover it.
But they're not going to give you 3 years worth of money. It's just not going to happen.
Yeah.
Like, they don't take FAFSA. It's like not even part of that system. Yeah.
What about Canada as an option for kids that are looking into?
So if you have kids who have any Canadian citizenship in them whatsoever, even if it's like a mom or a dad, it is actually a very good deal. It's the same three-year system. You pick a program and you go really fast. But I actually have a client whose kid is going up to Canada. It's ridiculously cheap. It's like,
yeah, it's about $12,000 a year.
Yeah, it's like under 10 grand a year.
I went to visit University of British Columbia, which is very similar to University of Washington. The weather's slightly better.
Yeah.
But again, they're not, for out of country, it's incredibly expensive. So I have kids who tell me I want to go study in Mexico. I say, well, that's interesting because you'll get an entry from Mexico and you can get, that's right, exactly. But you don't want to go someplace where you're going to incur debt.
Wait, what do you pay if you go to Mexico?
There's no money. I mean, if you're a citizen or a
free
citizen,
free.
It's free.
Okay.
Yeah, they don't want to incur debt to go to college, but
sure.
I love studying abroad and that will be covered. That will be paid for.
So when we're discussing international colleges, I know folks who are immigrated into the United States and their degrees were not valid in the United States.
Right.
So is there a rule of like which schools are accredited and which ones are not?
Well, you should definitely have them look at accreditation.
Okay.
So every
if they want to be a doctor or a lawyer, absolutely. You know.
Well, so the thing is, if you're going to be a doctor or a lawyer, it's about the advanced degree, right? But so I actually did a session at this workshop that we went to a month ago about helping pre-med kids. And so the question there was, there's a lot of medical schools offshore, they call it offshore, and that's a problem because then you won't be able to take the boards in the U.S. because they don't recognize that. They don't recognize offshore degrees. So that is a problem.
So bachelors are okay? Just
bachelors might be okay. It depends on the accreditation. And the truth is they might have to produce a transcript with a very detailed syllabus for every class they took, just proving that they're qualified.
I mean, I had a girl I worked with who was pointed at fashion design. So I said, okay, let's look around. And she had a British mother, and she's in England going into fashion school, which is one of the best programs anywhere.
Yeah.
But that's all she's doing. She's just doing a degree in fashion. There's nothing else.
Well, and the other, I mean, that's a good example. That's a major that's very directly related to a career.
Right.
And what I help kids look at is what kind of internship opportunities can you find that this school will help you find while you're in college? Because a huge percentage of kids who leave college with a job offer do it because they interned somewhere in college or they got a job in the summer. And so today it's not about the degree, it's about the experience that you,
mm-hmm.
I don't mean the experience, I mean the job experience you get while you're getting the degree. Did you talk about co-ops at all?
Mm-hmm.
Colleges with co-ops? Okay, so you guys know about the co-op schools, they're incredible. And the kids who go to co-op schools leave with job offers at a much higher rate than
And higher salaries.
Right. Yeah, absolutely.
Cool.
Yeah,
thank you.
Yep.
So you have all across the socioeconomic spectrum that you're working with. How do you help them build their list?
So it's funny because I've had the privilege, I guess, to work with different communities. Before I was a college counselor, I was a college advisor with UCLA's early academic outreach program. And so our main focus was just get students to apply, because these communities were, you know, a lot of students didn't think about college, families didn't think about college. So my job was to make sure that their list matched, you know, their GPA, matched their extracurricular activities, matched their SAT scores. So it was funny because back then I said, okay, do you have UCs? If you're above a 3.0, you have to apply to UCs. If you're above a 2.5, you have to apply to Cal States. And that's what I concentrated on. When I moved over, my first college counseling job was with Eagle Rock. And in there, there was already some differences. There was a little bit more lower income students, but there was a lot more affluent students as well. And they were talking about private schools, and it wasn't a conversation about, like, do I want to go to college? It's like, I'm going to go to college. Like, where do I apply? So then I started noticing, like, okay, these kids, it's a whole different conversation that they need to find a college that's going to fit them well, which made me rethink everything I did before, but okay. And then when I went to LACES, I was like, oh, gosh, like, these kids really, really know what they're talking about already. Of course, I have some students that are first generation, low income, so I still have that, but it's a very different conversation with students that know they're going to go to college and they have the support from their families. And so it's a mixed bag. When I sit down with my students, I usually sit down with them, and I have the luxury to do this because my junior class is about 2:30, my senior class is about 2:15. And the way I split my year is my fall is just for the seniors. Like, everything I do is just for the seniors. And then my spring is just for the juniors. And of course, other little things that I do. But I have the luxury of being able to sit down with them and talking to them about what they want to do when they go off to college. And I do have Naviance. I've had Naviance for the past 2 years, which makes a little bit easier for the advising, because I can require for them, before I meet with them as juniors, I require them to do a junior survey where I ask questions like this, not as detailed as the cards, but it does talk about, like, what's the size, am I willing to go outside, am I, you know, do I want a school that has, you know, all these schools, Division I school, sports, things like that, so we ask that, and then I have them also create a preliminary list of colleges that they're applying to. And when I see this, it kind of gives me an idea before I talk to them of where they stand. If they have, like, UCLA, USC, and Cal State LA, it means that they don't have a lot of knowledge about what colleges are out there. If they have, you know, Denison, Bennington, and this, I know they have a private college counseling. So then that means it's a different conversation with each student. I do go in the classrooms and do presentations. I do it in the junior, like in January, February, and we talk about having a list of colleges. And I recommend for my students to have about 12 schools. Some go overboard and do like 25, which is way too much. I think it's way too much. 12, and I always say 12 because in there you should have a mix of UCs, a private school, an out-of-state school, and a mix of Cal States. And I love Cal States because they're so straightforward in terms of their admissions. Like, we were talking to an admissions person yesterday, it's your GPA and your SAT scores. And if you have the magic number, if it's, you know, a local school admission lower, if it's not, it's a little bit higher. So I always tell students, there's guaranteed colleges out there for you. And Cal States are the only ones that do that for you. And it kind of eases their anxiety because it's like, oh, I'm going to get in somewhere, right? Versus like, I'm not going to get anywhere, and I have a 3.8 GPA, I'm not going to get anywhere. So it kind of eases their anxiety. So I always tell them about having safety schools, target schools, and reaches. Especially, I stress this because different classes have different makeup. So the, you know, honors and AP classes tend to be the more affluent students. The regular classes tend to be the more lower income students. So I stress for the reach for those students in the regular classes because they tend not to reach high. They underestimate themselves. They don't apply to the colleges that they could get into. So I stress a little bit more on that. If it's a classroom with more affluent students, then I talk more about target because they're really reaching. They want to go to Harvard, Yale, Princeton. And so I talk about the target and how do you making sure you have a safety school. So I have that conversation way before we talk and they start making their list. And so when I talk to them one-on-one, which is like 20 minutes really after we sit down with everything, and we kind of look over their list, and I can tell, like I said, if they And if they're like, well, they kind of sounded good, it's like, okay, we got to do some research. Or like sometimes we'll have reasons. Well, I like the East Coast, and I visited these schools, and I really like them, and blah, blah, blah. So then I know I have a student that knows a little bit more. And then what I love to do with them is I run a college search on Naviance, because there is one on Naviance, and you can do it based on the criteria that they like. And so sometimes they'll have like three colleges on their list. I'm like, look, you can do this, this, and this, and then we get like 20. It's like, you don't have to apply to each one, but you can start looking at what you like, and then we'll look at the pictures. And I encourage them that that's what they have to do during, you know, between junior and senior year, to start looking for those colleges. And with some students, I'll spend more time on that. Other students, I spend more time on the process. It just depends on the level of the student. But I do try to look at everybody's list to make sure that there's like some of a little bit of everything, the reach, the target, and the safety schools. Big Future, you've already mentioned, is really good. College Data is really good. You know, students are pretty savvy. A lot of them are starting to do more research on colleges. Like I tell them when I do my presentation, like back in my day, I would have to mail a request for catalogs or whatever, and then by the time I got it, it would be super, you know, 2-3 weeks passed by, I forgot about that college. So they have the ease of having the internet in front of them. And I stress to the parents when I do the parent meetings that they go visit colleges. That's such a big, big thing. And even students that have applied to certain colleges and they get into colleges, and they know they want to go to this one college, when they go to the college visit, it totally changes. They're like, oh, I hated it. It's like, I didn't like it. And so they end up going with their second choice, which is, you know, super amazing, because it might have been the school that I recommended. So it's just, it's a balance, and what I do is a balance between doing it in big groups and do it individually. I don't have as much time as I do with the students as I wish I did, and I probably have a little bit more time than other college counselors that have 750 seniors, but I really, really believe that having that one-on-one with the students helps tremendously, because even just showing them the website, because you can talk and like, go to this website, and make sure you go to this website and that website, but when you sit down with them and actually do it, it changes the way they're like, oh, I can navigate this. One of the other websites that they are going to stay in California that I like to use is californiacolleges.edu. Mm-hmm. It's really good for California. And I use WUI, I just do searches. I tell the students, like, there's this magical thing called Google. And then, so if you look.
Do you not have the Google on your computer? Is that unique to mine?
So they're like, oh, I want to be, what was one major that I kept telling me? Like, I want to study engineering in petroleum excavation or something. Let's see what majors, colleges that provide blah, blah, blah. And there's always something, and if it's not the list, it'll kind of guide you towards it, where it is. So really teaching our students that the answer is out there, they just have to find it, and that helps a lot. But like I said in the beginning, I think the majority of my time spent with students is just easing their anxiety, because they're so anxious. They feel like, I keep hearing getting into college is hard, and you have these 3.5 students that think they're not going to get into college. And it's like, what are you talking about? Like, you're a 3.5 student, you're going to get in somewhere. And so easing that and mixing their list with reaches and safety and target schools, and understanding what that means. And one of the things I do suggest for students to do, just because, maybe because I came from the communities where lots of things would happen in families and family situations would change, is always have one local school that you're willing to go to. Because life happens, things change, and you might have to stay home or stay close to home. And so that way they have an option. And it's always usually one of the guaranteed colleges, you know, that they have guaranteed to get in.
Can I have an ISO pen that we did? Oh, my ISO pen's one. We can write on the,
So can we actually say, is your daughter a junior?
She is, yeah.
So
you
might be able to help us with all the lists.
She is a lower division.
Oh, she's transferring?
Yes.
Okay, got it. He's visiting college right now.
One of the things that, and Eric has sort of touched on this, one of the things I learned really early was if you ask a 17-year-old to research something, what they're going to do is they're going to open up the homepage, and then they're going to go, okay, I looked at it. Because the pictures are pretty, and yeah. So, awesome. So what I actually made a little video, but what I would have them do if I were you is give them specific things to look for within that website, right? So every college website has a category called academics. That's why
were really open when I went to my first NACAC meeting in San Diego.
Yeah.
That was the first time, like I said, most of my work was done with Cal State and UCs. And then when I went to that meeting, that conference, I was just like, wow, like there's so many colleges that we're just hitting like the tip of the iceberg that are out there, and they have amazing programs, and you know, they're specific to different students. And like I said, right now there's a lot of talk in the college world about fit, because we were doing a better job about getting the kids into college. They're getting in there, but are they finishing is the question. And so if the student fits well in a college, and they're more likely to continue, more likely to complete their degree, and that's what colleges and you know the U.S. and the government wants to see. So there's a lot of conversation about that, more so than before, I think. And so getting to know the colleges, doing the college visits yourself, or going with the students really helps. Like, I've done a couple in these last 2 years, and it's really opened my eyes to, like, okay, there are a lot of colleges. Like, I see students when I'm walking around, like, oh, I can totally so see so-and-so here.
Yeah.
Or even when I'm talking to them, like, oh, yeah, I remember, you know, we talked about this one program at this university. It makes it a little bit more vivid than reading it off of the website. So the more colleges you can visit,
yeah, because I was at a school and this kid came to me and he said, I want to major in film. And I said, but your list, none of them have film programs. So I just said, you're looking at the schools that people who want to be a science major are going to, or political science, but there are all these schools in California that have film programs, believe it or not. And then Loyola Marymount doesn't care if you have experience, and Pepperdine doesn't care if you have experience. They just want you to be a storyteller. So I had to reframe his list to look at the schools that actually had programs that would give him money.
And I would say, you know, the NACAC fairs conference is totally overwhelming. They have fairs, right? There's a fair in Pasadena, there's a fair in Ventura, there's a fair in Ontario. In the fall and the spring, maybe 350 colleges go. That's a really good place for you to meet the reps. But I would tell kids, and I do tell kids, don't feel like you're cutting off your arm. There's 2,200 four-year colleges out there. We're not going to look at all of them. We don't have time, right? If we started when you were in kindergarten, we wouldn't have time. So you don't feel like we're missing something. And sometimes I feel like they think we're missing something.
Yeah.
And so when I, like I said, we do phase one is the looking, phase two is the applying. We have an actual meeting around Labor Day, right around when school starts, and we sort of finalize their list. Yes, things change. But we tell them, like, now is the time to stop with that searching part. You've done your homework. You did what I asked you to do. Now it's time to put in the work to apply. But don't feel like you're cutting off your own. Like, just go with and have confidence in what you found.
Cool. So I have an activity where on the Google Docs, I have group A has one kid to work with to come up with a list. The Bs have a kid to work with to come up with a list. And the Cs. So the A's are going to be over here. The B's are going to be over here. The C's are going to be over here. Remember the, and just go look at the kid, and I want you to come up with 8 colleges for the kids to apply. Only 3 of it can be public. The rest of them have to be, what?
Tough.
I mean, because they can do the publics. They can do the, yeah, that's easy. I mean, they're going to get their free 4 Cal States. You can figure out which Cal State you would like them to go to. But go take a look. So it's on the Google Docs. I can put it up here, too. The A's have one kid, the B's have another kid, the C's have another kid.